Hello aspirants, looking at current affairs for 2nd December, the news items picked up from the Hindu newspaper are these 10. We'll look at them in detail. The first one, FM seeks to allay depositors' fears, hints at review of bill. So this is regarding the financial resolution and deposit insurance bill of 2017. So a draft of this bill is out in the public domain, and this bill is set to be introduced in the parliament in the winter session. So some provisions in this bill have resulted in fears amongst the population, amongst the depositors, and that is why the finance minister has hinted that a review of this bill would take place. This is not the final bill which will be placed before the legislature, before the parliament. It is at the drafting stage. So there will be several corrections before it is passed. So this is a hint given by the finance minister here. So actually this bill is talking of scrapping the Deposit Insurance and Credit Guarantee Corporation. This is a body that guarantees repayment of all bank deposits up to 1 lakh rupees in case of a stressed bank being liquidated. So when a bank is under stress and it's liquidated, it is being sold off, it's, you know, the recovery is taking place. Bank deposits are also given this guarantee of repayment under the Deposit Insurance and Credit Guarantee Corporation. So you have, if you're insuring deposits under DICGC, this body, then you will get returns up to rupees 1 lakh. So this body being scrapped, and actually the bill talks of replacing it with Resolution Corporation under the Finance Ministry, which will have representatives from stock market, banking, insurance, and even pension fund regulators. So how much of the insurance would be provided by Resolution Corporation is not clear. So in the bill, the provision is that the corporation, Resolution Corporation, shall in consultation with appropriate regulators specify the total amount payable by the corporation with respect to any one depositor as to his deposit insured under this act in the same capacity and in the same right. So how much, to what extent the deposits would be guaranteed? This is the doubt being created because of such ambiguous provisions in the bill, and that is why depositors feel they may have varying degrees of haircuts or write downs. Means they will have to face the cuts. They may not get even up to 1 lakh rupees returns ensured. So this is the problem in the bill, and the finance minister is presently giving assurance that it will come up for review. So here you can see the bill's provisions are listed out here. So it's a bill for bankruptcy related cases, bankruptcy of banks, businesses such as banks. So it has a provision of bail-in also. So bail-in is to provide, purpose is to provide capital to absorb the losses of a bank to ensure its survival. So somebody can bail in. So here survival does not mean survival of depositors' money, but it is restoration of the capital of the bank. So that is why depositors have their own concerns. So as you can see, with a bail-in, bank can simply refuse payment of a customer's money and instead issue securities such as preference shares. So this is the case. Then next is, Nissan seeks $770 million in tax dispute with Tamil Nadu. So Japanese automaker Nissan Motors has begun international arbitration against India to seek more than $770 million in a dispute over unpaid state incentives. So this is actually in the state of Tamil Nadu. The Tamil Nadu government had actually come up with incentives, and the Nissan Motors as such is demanding those incentives now. So it was a 2008 agreement under which Nissan Motors set up its car manufacturing plant in Tamil Nadu. So here now, after 4 years as such of having its, of functioning, now Nissan wants the incentives being provided to it, which the Tamil Nadu government has not provided so far. Nissan had also written to the Prime Minister talking about this issue, but then from the Prime Minister to finally no steps have been taken, though assurances had been given by various ministries that the payment would be made and Nissan should not go for international arbitration. But now the ultimatum had been issued and the international arbitration has been initiated. So international arbitration, this has been quite frequently in news. India also doesn't want international arbitrations from foreign investors, because even with Japan, we have Nissan is a Japanese company, so we have a comprehensive economic partnership agreement with Japan. So the company is claiming that there are violations as such by India under this agreement. So that is why it is seeking international arbitration proceedings now. So this actually our international arbitration has been sought in over 20 cases against India. So this is said to be among the highest against any single nation as such. So this is another case being added now. So there have been many cases of retrospective taxation, that taxes are being demanded later for the period which has already gone. Means I'm introducing, the government is introducing a tax presently, but it is asking companies, even foreign investors, to pay those taxes even for their earlier operation. So such retrospective taxes and payment disputes have resulted in international arbitrations. So here in case of Nissan, what had happened is that it had invested, it has says it has invested 6,100 crores in the following 7 years, and it has been producing vehicles here, and the government of Tamil Nadu had ensured returns in the form of value added tax. So returns would have, refund would be provided, value added tax refund, but that has not been provided by the Tamil Nadu government. The Tamil Nadu government says that this refund actually, it claim this has to come only when the accruals reach the level of investment, and that has not taken place. And also it says that these benefits are spread over a period of 21 years. So with 4 years of operation now, it is saying that the company Nissan Corporation, Nissan Motors, is trying to claim double benefits out of the project. It has set up its own marketing entity, and it shows that all its sales have taken place with this marketing entity, and it is claiming a refund. So this is the Tamil Nadu government stand. And now an international arbitration would be initiated in this case. So here the further gist of the entire matter is also mentioned. The next is state's views sought on triple talaq law. So the government is going to introduce a bill in the parliament in the present winter session. This is Muslim Women Protection of Rights on Marriage Bill. So this is a bill which is on a subject in the concurrent list, because marriage and divorce comes under the concurrent list. So in the concurrent list in the constitution, even the state as well as the center can make law on that matter. So parliament is also empowered to make a law, and state legislature too. But in case of parliament frames a law, then that law prevails. So, but then the Sarkaria Commission on Center State Relations has given its recommendation that when the central government makes a law on a subject in the concurrent list, it should consult the states. So this recommendation is being adhered to now, and the central government has sent this bill to all the states government, state governments, asking for their views. The draft as such has been prepared by a group of ministers headed by Home Minister Rajnath Singh, and the major provisions you can see are listed below. So it covers all cases of instant triple talaq. So triple talaq is basically only instant triple talaq, that is talaq-e-bidat. So this is covered for our entire country except in Jammu and Kashmir, and a maximum jail term of 3 years is imposed, and a fine as well, on a Muslim man for giving instant triple talaq or talaq-e-bidat to his wife. So instant triple talaq means immediately saying 3 times talaq and divorce is granted. So this has become a non-bailable cognizable offense. Also, it is in any form, instant triple talaq in any form, written, electronic, through SMS, WhatsApp, email, everything has been banned in the country now. So already we had seen in August 2017, Supreme Court has passed this judgment claiming instant triple talaq illegal and unconstitutional. But still the government said that this practice is still going on. There have been 66 cases post this judgment also come forth. So that is why government is framing this bill. Also in this bill, there is a provision for subsistence allowance to the victim and her dependent children, and gives her the custodial rights to minor children. So this safeguard is also there in this place, in this bill. Then the next news item is Kerala plays matchmaker to smallest cow. So this Muhamma Panchayat in Kerala's Alappuzha district has set up a natural mating center for vechur cattle. So you should know about vechur cattle. This is a rare breed. It is said to be the smallest cattle breed in the world. Its height is only of around average of around 90 centimeter and weighs around 130 kg. So this is on the verge of extinction to Kerala Agricultural University. They launched a conservation program about 2 decades ago. This vechur cattle, the species, the breed, you should know, because environment biodiversity is also an important topic in UPSC. So vechur cow milk is considered good for health too, as it has health, as it is got high proportion of smaller fat globules and saturated fatty acids. So this is the vechur cow. and this is a region in Kerala here where it is been bred through a natural breeding center. Then next is MP has most number of repeat offenders. So this is again from the data published by National Crime Records Bureau. It is seen that the percentage of juveniles, means below 18 years of age, and those who repeat a crime at least once is same as that for adult criminals. So this percentage wise, the data from 29 states and the 7 union territories is shown, and the maximum number of repeat offenders in terms of percentage is from Chandigarh. And in terms of absolute numbers, the maximum number of repeated offenders amongst adults is in Madhya Pradesh. So this is the data. Another important point mentioned in this article is regarding repeat sexual offenders. So Home Ministry has told the Parliament the details of sexual offenders even below 18 years of age would be included in a database which would be put up on the National Crime Records Bureau website. So the government is going to initiate having a sex offenders registry. This was a proposal by Ministry of Women and Child Development earlier too. So this sex offenders registry would have the entire database, would have the photograph, address, PAN card details, Aadhaar card number, and the fingerprints, DNA samples, details as such in the registry of all sexual offenders. Because then the repeat offense would not take place is the idea. But then this is also a controversial initiative. But government has said that this will be put up. UPA government had first proposed this sexual offenders registry after the 2012 gang rape case in Delhi. So now this may be put into effect. And this is the data regarding repeat offenders in terms of, you know, percentage wise. And also lowest percentage of repeat offenders shown. And also highest percentage shown as such amongst juveniles as such. Then next is India silent on Maldives China FTA. So Maldives, a small state here, island nation actually, an archipelago in Indian Ocean. So this Maldives, which is a neighbor of India and across the Indian Ocean, so this has signed a free trade agreement with China. So Maldives is considered as a close ally of India, close partner of India. It has historical relations, but now it has been seen that it is coming closer to the Chinese government under the present government in power. The opposition leader and former president of Maldives, Mohammad Nasheed, has said that the free trade agreement between Maldives and China will be detrimental to Maldives' economy, as balance of trade is greatly in favor of China. So this is a point being raised by him. But India has presently maintained a silence because the details of the FTA would have to be studied first. Then next is way to remove poll commissioner's wig. So PIL petition had been filed in the Supreme Court by an advocate, and this PIL argued that under Article 324(5) of the Constitution, which calls for removal of election commissioners in the Constitution, there are safeguards for removal of chief election commissioner. That he cannot be arbitrarily removed, because the provision is that he can be removed in the same manner and same procedure as a judge of Supreme Court. So CEC has got safeguards. But then in case of election commission, actually comprises of chief election commissioner and two other election commissioners if required. So these two other election commissioners or their removal, there is only one provision mentioned, that it should be on the recommendation of the chief election commissioner. So the same provision is not applicable for election commissioners. So why these two election commissioners do not have the same safeguards? All three are actually considered equal because they have a tenure of 6 years and they have a term up to 65 years of age, and they have same status, same salaries, perks as available to Supreme Court judges. Even enjoy the same decision-making powers. Then why is the safeguard not provided to election commissioners is a question being raised here. So this is the provision in the Constitution. If you have read polity in depth, then you would be knowing about these provisions already. So this petition in the Supreme Court is demanding, questioning why election commissioners are not given the same safeguards as CEC. So on this, the Supreme Court has sought a response from the Attorney General. So he will be assisting the Supreme Court in this matter now. So this is an important issue in polity. So in short, the petition actually wants that the same safeguards which are provided to chief election commissioner should also be provided to election commissioner as well. So here the details as such are provided, how the chief election commissioner is removed and any other cannot be removed except on the recommendation of Chief Election Commissioner. So, this is there. Then next is Cabinet gives nod to nutrition mission. So the Union Cabinet has now approved to launch this national nutrition mission, which will target reducing malnutrition and low birth weights by 2% each year. So this, there is a 9046 crore budget for this mission for a period of 3 years. And basically this mission will be first covering the 315 worst affected districts in the present financial year and then expanded to all the states and districts. So this basically, this mission on nutrition, we have various schemes and policies in place, but the core idea behind this mission is set to converge all the existing programs on a single platform. Because there are various schemes, like there is Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana, under which the pregnant and lactating women are given direct benefit transfer, benefits money is transferred to them. So this is a program under the Ministry of Women and Child Development. Then there is Mission Intradhanush, which is for immunization of women and children. So this is under Ministry of Health. So to bring in convergence of all these missions with respect to nutrition, the National Nutrition Mission is being proposed now. So the target is also to bring down stunting in children, because even stunting in children is as high as 38.4% in India. So this should be brought down to 25% by 2022 is a target. Then also to bring down anemia among children, deficiency in iron. So this is seen in children, even women and adolescent girls. So this should be brought down by 3% every year. Also, there is an issue being raised whether Aadhaar would be mandatory for this mission or not, because you can be a beneficiary under it only if you have Aadhaar. So it has been stated that yes, Aadhaar is mandatory, but then Aadhaar for children below 3 years of age is also a question. So it has been stated that yes, Aadhaar would be mandatory, but no beneficiary would be denied benefit for lack of Aadhaar. So this is a statement coming from Women and Child Development Secretary. It has been stated that many fake children enrolled in Anganwadis have also been seen in a pilot study in Assam. So this results in a loss of around 30 lakh per day going into this fake, you know, enrollments. So that's why government is insisting on Aadhaar. So that has been justified. And this is regarding Pradhan Mantri Matra Vandana Yojana. So here you can see direct benefit transfer of 6,000 rupees is given to pregnant and lactating women. 1,000 at the time of registration when they're pregnant, and then 2,000 at time of prenatal checkup after 6 months of pregnancy, and 3,000 at time of vaccination to the baby. So this is a direct benefit transfer scheme initiated. So pregnant women, this is only there for rural area population, and women working in central or state government or similar such forms will not be covered under this because they have their own benefits. And this is regarding Mission Indradhanush. So Indradhanush, as they have 7 colors, the scheme also covers 7 diseases against which vaccination would be provided. So these 7 diseases are diphtheria, whooping cough, tetanus, polio, tuberculosis, measles and hepatitis B. First initial 201 districts were identified, and gradually it will cover up the entire nation. Then next is, in expanding Africa role, US set to fly armed drones in Niger. So the government of Niger and US Department of Defense Department have signed an agreement according to which permission has been given to US Defense Department to fly armed drones out of the capital of Niger, that is Niamey. So here Pentagon officials have said that this will result in a major expansion of US military's footprints in Africa. So earlier drones were flown, but now drones without arms, now with arms too they can be flown. So this would help USA in fighting extremism in West Africa. So USA already has drones in place in its another base, which is in Djibouti and also in Italy. So from Djibouti, the drones target Yemen, Somalia and Libya, the extremists here, and from Italy, they are flying to Libya. So this is already in place, and now government of USA would also get further base in Niger where they can use armed drones. So this is shown here, Niger flying here. So this will be approaching West African region, will be covered Boko Haram, which is a major terrorist organization here in Nigeria, Al-Qaeda an Islamist Maghreb, another jihadist present here in this region. And then Italy, which is in Europe up here, so it can help in attacks on terrorist organizations in Libya and Djibouti for West Asia. Then next is government eases mine auction rules. So this is regarding the changes which have taken place for mining auctions, because mining for major minerals, this had been made through auctions as such 2 years ago. So government has seen that there has been a lackluster response to this auctioning as such, because initially 33 blocks as such have been successfully auctioned, but as many as 60 auctions have flopped because there has been lack of interest. And now government is looking forward to further opening up around 100 blocks for auction over the next 15 months. So to ensure that there is sufficient interest and investors bid for these minerals, the mines as such, the changes have been made. So these changes you can see are, number one, that states can now allocate blocks even if there is less than 3 bidders in fray during the second round of auction. So earlier provision was that in the first 3 round of auctions, there should be at least 3 bidders. But now even if less than 3 means even if there are 2 bidders in the second round, auction would still take place. So this is a relaxation in rules. Second is the net worth requirement. So for bidding, prospective bidders should have at least minimum net worth, and this minimum net worth has also been relaxed. So for average annual output of 2 crores, bidders needed had to have an annual net worth of you can see, but that has been slashed down to 0.5 crores. So now with 50 lakhs also you can bid for a mine with average annual output of 2 crores. Also for a mine of annual output of 20 crores, the net worth norm earlier was 40 crores, now it has come down to 10 crores. So these are the changes which have been made in net worth requirements too. Also, third change which has been made is in end use conditions. So in case of mines being allotted, miners had to use them for particular end use condition were put forth, but now miners can dispose of 25% of unused low grade ore as such on their own. So this end use conditions have also been relaxed. And the last one is that the clause or to discourage miners from squatting on mine leases is there in place. So means they should not sit on the mines. Means once you have been allotted a mine, your mine leases will be effective for 3 years. So within 3 years, you have to be ready to mine. If you don't, then you can't keep on holding on that mining lease. So this is a safeguard as such also added up. So this is there. So since the amendments have been made and for major minerals, competitive bidding or mining has been made mandatory, so this e-auction or competitive bidding has to take place. So under this, there are stringent provisions, which some of them have been relaxed now. And already there is a provision under this too, that a contribution has to go from the miners to district mineral fund, which is also used for Pradhan Mantri Khanij Kalyan Yojana. So this is for development of the project affected area, because when mining takes place, the adjoining region is affected. So to ensure development in that region and employment for that region, this district mineral fund has been established. So it will develop the project at affected area. And there's also a contribution going to National Mineral Exploration Trust. So this will enhance the mineral base and promote exploration. So these are the news items. Thank you.